Thank you to Rhonda for the story. I think it's incredible that Rhonda has the tenacity to search 2 hours for a particular pair of pajama pants. You know, it also reminds me, though, that our Father in Heaven also always wants us to be seeking Him. I'm going to drop a little nugget for you, something to contemplate as we enter prayer and rest of praise and worship. Seeking. Why don't you spell that out? Let's use lowercase S-E-E, but uppercase K-I-N-G. Let's always be seeking, and we will see the King. Amen. Thank you for being with us online. We're glad to have everyone here together. If you would, join me in prayer as we get things started. Father God, please open our hearts so that we can receive you. Let us always open our eyes so we can be seeking you. Please give us that same tenacity that Rhonda mentioned this morning, seeking 2 hours to find pajama pants, but let us seek you always. Let us always seek you. When we know that we have you inside us, let us remember to continue pursuing. We thank you for all the blessings that you pour out on us, and we ask that you bless this service. Through the rest of this praise and worship, receive us seeking you in the name of Jesus. Amen.
A powerless slave. Then heaven reached down from the cross to my soul. Hell started to shake and it had to let go. I'll never get over it. I'll never get over it. I was dead in my sin, but your love wouldn't quit. And I'll never get is healing every wound. Your blood is making all things new. Your blood, it speaks a better word. It's more than I deserve. Your blood, it speaks a better word. It speaks a better word. It's seeming now with life. It's shouting down the lies. It echoes through the night. The precious blood of Christ speaks a better word, speaks a better word. Your blood, a robe of righteousness. Your blood, my hope and my defense. Your blood forever covers me, forever covers me.
Cover. Moving here in front of me,
the silencing my every fear, silencing my every fear.
I tell you what, I was especially moved by that song. A great message in the heart, awesome subwoofer in the belly. You may have a seat, and young people, children, you can head off to Children's Church. Enjoy your time with your teachers. Give them a big, big hug. Yes. Woo! What a great start this morning. Are you excited? So I'm going to continue our efforts here in praise and worship by receiving of the offering. I'm going to ask our deacons, our men's ministry leader to visit here in the sanctuary, but remind you online, if you're ready to pour out, provide your tithe, bring your offerings, you can do so online at www.covenantlifedfw.com/giving. We'll take you straight to that giving page. I want to remind everyone that, you know, we will be blessed when it is that when we give. And there's abundance that's expected. And I'm going to ask of you to remember that in your abundance that you bring those offerings. In your abundance, be reminded that it's not of you alone, that you've been blessed and that you bring the offering in your abundance. And often, I'm just going to encourage you to think, when you are thanking Jesus and our King for the abundance that you have, that you remember those are great moments to return that to the kingdom. Amen? If you would, join me in prayer over the offering and tithe this morning. Father God, we thank you for all the blessings you pour out to us, that we come back to you in the abundance that you provide, in remembrance of you, that we bring our offering, that we bring our tithe. This is not a giving, this is a bringing. This is yours in the first place, and we bring it back to you. We ask that you bless it, that you multiply it as you do, that you put it to good use, that your will be done, and that we can help that kingdom come here on earth. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, I hope you're excited. I'm going to get into a few announcements. First, tonight at 5 p.m., Abide Prayer right here at CLC. So please join for Abide Prayer, 5 p.m. right here at CLC. A great opportunity to pray for self, for church, community, government. A great opportunity to come together in prayer tonight. Now, I'm going to also talk to the men a bit this morning, because very exciting news. Starting in February will be Wednesday Bible study. So Wednesdays at 7 p.m. Now, I forget. Is that February 7th that we start that? February 1st? 1st. February 1st. So be here February 1st, 7 p.m. each week. It's this Wednesday. So this Wednesday, February 1st, 7 p.m., men, be here for Bible study. We'll kick that off. We'll be here weekly. Very excited about that. Amen? That didn't sound exciting at all. All right. Holy Spirit, please come and open up some minds, some hearts, and some voices here today. Men, will you be here for Wednesday Bible study and excited? Yes. Awesome. Youth, do we have any youth in the house? Yeah, okay. I'm not sure anyone is here today. That's okay, Pastor. You're going to have a great time today. Youth is putting together an awesome event for Valentine's Day. Now, incredible event. Now, I think the youth probably know about this, and the announcement's probably not speaking out to them. I'm going to let everyone here in the audience understand what the youth are doing for Valentine's Day so that we can pray for them. That's what I've been asked to announce here. The youth are come together on February 11th at 11 a.m., Saturday, February 11th, 11 a.m., to distribute Valentine's cards into the neighborhood in this community. What a wonderful opportunity. Apparently, this is a neighborhood that is not easily traveled, so they're probably not often bothered by solicitors. So we're very much hoping they're going to open their doors, because they will be receiving a wonderful opportunity from our youth, giving them a Valentine's card, handwritten notes, and prayer over them in that opportunity. So I'm going to ask everyone that's not youth, where's my not youth? There we go. Plenty of old people here. Be in prayer. I want you also to pray for the youth in this moment. And I want you to remember, on Saturday the 11th at 11 a.m., be in prayer for them. How awesome would it be that if you took an hour out of your Saturday to be in prayer over the youth that are going into our community, praying over the people in the community? What can happen from that? Amen? Awesome. Well, okay, I'm going to end on a good idea then. Thank you, Teresa. And I'm going to encourage you to please get a little bit more energy behind you today as I'm inviting Pastor up here to get us going. Are we ready for that? Let's welcome Pastor, please.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Tom. All right. Well, good morning, everybody. Thank you. Praise the Lord. Before we get into the message and everything else this morning, I have Teresa coming and told me about something that she has on her heart to share. It's just a little thing, but I think it's going to be helpful to many of you. So, Teresa, do you want to come and say these few words?
Thank you, Pastor. I just want to encourage you guys and bless you. So when I came to church today, believe it or not, I was not happy, and I was not joy-filled, and I was pretty overwhelmed and pretty discouraged. And so I diligently went to pre-service prayer like I do, and every prayer just lined up with what was on my heart and the burden that was on my heart. And I want you to know that the Lord sees us, and he hears us, and he knows where we're at. And then all the prayers said, but you need to be vulnerable and you need to be willing to acknowledge what your struggles are, because then the Lord can come in and he can touch them and he can heal them. And so at the end of prayer, I said, okay, friends, I need some prayer. And I cried, but I told them what was going on, and they totally related to me and they understood my need and my desperation. And with me, they cried out to the Lord, and they're believing with me for victory. And we all have different reports, and we have different people and things that we can believe. But I'm going to choose to believe the report of the Lord. But we all need to be vulnerable and be willing to submit ourselves. And so we've got Abide Prayer tonight. You're welcome to come later, I'm sure. And there's people here that'll pray for you after the service. But if you don't feel led then, hey, come back at 5 o'clock. And that would be a great opportunity, because there is hope in the kingdom of God. The enemy comes to speak despair and overwhelming and frustrating things. But we serve a God who lives and who reigns, and he sees us. And he knows the burdens of our heart. And he is a burden-lifting, yoke-destroying God. And he can do it. So we serve an awesome God, and we have a great church. And I love you guys.
All right. Thank you, Jesus. Well, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. That's encouraging. And really, I just want to echo with that and say, guys, this is why we have church. We're not supposed to be a lone ranger in the world, right? And we all go through stuff, and we all have bad days and less good days and great days. But, hey, this is why we are here together, to encourage each other and pray for each other and root for each other. So please, we encourage you to do that. So I have an announcement before we actually go into the message today. The announcement that I want to make is Genevieve and I, we have friends that are coming over next week. Their name are Michael and Kathy Real, and they are French artists. From France. They are missionaries from France, and we've known them for, I don't know, like more than 25 years. And when I was in Mauritius, they came multiple times to minister to our church, and they are missionaries. They've been missionaries especially to the French-speaking nations, and lately they've been to the United States for about a year or so, and so they flew back to France. But they are doing like a tour for 2 weeks or so, and in the south of the U.S. So their first stop is going to be with us here next week. So they're very, very deep people. They love Jesus, and I think we will benefit from what he's going to share with us next week. So you don't want to miss this. I hope you all be there. And also, as usual, you know, we do take a special offering for these people, because we want to bless them. You know, we want to bless the missionary work. You know, maybe many of us won't be able to go on mission trips, you know, around the world, but we can certainly plant a seed and be part of what they are doing. And when we get to heaven one day, you know what? We'll be part of the celebration with them. So don't forget to bring a seed. We're going to bless them next week. And don't forget to be there and bring your friends. Bring people you know. I think it's going to be powerful. So having said that, we are today in the power of Holy Communion. If you were here last week, we are in chapter 2. And that's going to be the only one that we're going to preach on, 1 and 2. And let me just give a little recap of what we said last week really quickly. One of the things that Jesus, first of all, Holy Communion is not something that is optional. It's mandatory. Like Jesus is really wanting us to take Holy Communion. He doesn't say if you take Holy Communion. He says when you take Holy Communion. In other words, we've got to do it as often as possible, he says, right? This is something that we've got to do. And he said when we take Holy Communion, one thing is very important, to remember. We got to remember and not forget. Remember what? First of all, we remember the cross, the sacrifice that he paid at Calvary for our redemption. The second thing that we want to remember is the covenant that was in his blood. And we talked a little about this last week, the covenant that Jesus shed with his blood when he died at the cross, the new covenant. And then the third thing is to eat and drink the elements, because eating and drinking of the communion table of the Lord brings blessing, right? There is a blessing in that. And, you know, I want to say God never tells us to do something that's going to be a burden to us. God tells us when he tells us to do something, it's for us to be blessed, to be strengthened, to be energized, to go forward, right? And he has ordained Holy Communion for us to be energized, to be empowered, to be blessed. And I want to tell you that you should not ignore that, and you should make this something in your life that is central in your life. Genevieve and I lately have been taking Holy Communion quite almost every day, but we do it in faith, and we do it remembering, seriously. And I'm telling you, we're already seeing some great results. But praise God, I know these blessings are there, and God wants us to be blessed. And especially, we want to have a time where we honor the Lord for all that he has given to us through his sacrifice. So this morning, I want to go a little deeper on the bread and the wine. So I believe that why did Jesus actually use bread and wine? That's a good question. Why did he actually use bread and wine? I believe that these are great practical visuals of his sacrifice he made for us. They are visuals. And every time you take that bread and you drink of that juice or that wine, it brings to remembrance of what he paid for, what he did at the cross, the sacrifice he did. And he used especially those two elements because I think they are loaded with imagery of what happened at the cross in his body. So let's look at the bread, right? Now, the bread that we're talking here was a flat, unleavened Jewish bread. It was not the soft, fluffy, doughy bread that we buy in the grocery stores. It was more of an unleavened bread, more of a cracker type bread. And this bread is called the matzah bread. The matzah bread. Now, we have a picture of the matzah bread. If we can show a picture of the matzah bread, this is the matzah bread. And by the way, I have actual matzah bread in my hand here. And also, it's right here. Can you see it? And the matzah bread, actually, another thing is that today we're going to take communion with a little cup of juice, but we're not going to use the wafer that we usually use. We're going to use matzah bread today. Okay? All right. So the matzah bread. So this bread, as you is a flat bread. It's an unleavened bread. It's a Jewish type bread that was made especially for Passover, right? They use this especially for Passover. Now, I want to talk to you a little bit about the characteristics of matzah bread. First of all, it's an unleavened bread. There's no leaven in the matzah bread. And, you know, the Bible very often, when it speaks of leaven, it speaks of sin. Leaven is synonymous to sin. And the fact that the bread is unleavened, there is no sin in the bread. So if the bread is equal to the body of Christ, guess what? The body of Christ is a body without sin. The Bible says it's unleavened. The Bible says he was tempted in every way, yet without sin. So when you take the bread, you are taking unleavened bread, which is Jesus' body, and the body of Jesus is without sin. Amen. So another thing about, another characteristic of the matzah bread that they use, and that Jesus used actually, is made of wheat. The matzah bread is made of wheat. Now, in order to remove, concerning wheat, in order to remove the stalks from the grain, wheat has to be beaten over and over again. That process is called the process of threshing. And what you do with the wheat is that you usually take some kind of tool, a wooden stick or something like that, and you'll put it against a hard surface, and you will beat that wheat over and over and over again until the grain is separated from the stalks, right? So that you can get the grain. It's quite a violent process. It's quite violent. And then the other thing that you do, because you want to turn the wheat into flour, you have to grind it so that it becomes powder. So first of all, you beat it and beat it repeatedly, and then you crush it until it becomes powder. And this is so speaks so much about what Jesus endured at the cross, right? Isaiah chapter 53, verse 4 and 5 says this: surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgression. And look at that part. He was crushed for our iniquities. So Jesus was beaten repeatedly by the Roman soldier over and over again. But not only beaten, he said he was crushed into a powder, like he would take that wheat and make it flour. He was crushed. So when you take the bread, you take the matzah bread, all these images come to your mind and you think about what Jesus went through. First of all, his body is unleavened, no sin. And secondly, his body was beaten and crushed. Are you still with me? So, and then another characteristic of the matzah bread. The matzah bread, let's show that picture again, Angela. The matzah bread. And if you see well, there are holes in the bread, right? There are holes. So the matzah bread had holes in it. That's another characteristic of that bread. The matzah bread had holes in it. It had holes in it. Now, and if we look at the verse that we just read right before that, if you can bring the verse in Isaiah. So he said, surely he took up our pain and our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. The next verse says, but he was pierced. Here's the holes. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. He was pierced. So the matzah bread has holes, signifying that Jesus' body was also pierced. The soldier standing at the cross while Jesus was on the cross, you remember, threw a spear in his side and pierced his side, and blood and water came out, right? And the crown of thorns that was placed on his head pierced his skull. And his hands were pierced, and his feet were pierced. He was pierced for our transgressions, crushed for our transgressions, for our sins. So when you take that bread, especially that matzah bread, and when the when Jesus took that bread, and especially the early church took that bread, because the Jewish made that bread, they would look at this, they would remember how he was crushed, he was beaten, and he was pierced, all for me. Now, isn't that powerful? Think about it. Another part of the bread, let's put that bread again, that if you don't mind, Angela, we're going to put that picture of the bread again. So another part of that bread is the bread is striped. You can see stripes on the bread. Actually, you can see in mine too, there are holes and there are stripes. There are stripes in that bread. The bread is striped. That's another characteristic of the bread. And of course, talking about Jesus' body, his body was striped. With the lashes that he received, you know, actually theologians say that when he was striped with the lashes, you could even see it, because that beating was so severe, so violent, there are chances that his inner parts were showing. Because the beating was so deep, the lashes were so deep, and so violent. Right? So his body was striped. Now we want to look at Isaiah chapter 53 verse 5. Let's read it together, everybody. Let's read. The chastisement for our peace, come on, was upon him. And by what? His stripes we are what? Healed. By his stripes we are healed. So when you take that bread, you remember that the body of Jesus was striped. And by this stripe at the cross, we are healed of depression. We are healed of disease and sicknesses. We are healed. So there is a lot going on in that bread. This is why I believe Jesus used that. Because the imagery of that is so rich. And another last thing that I want to share with you regarding the matzah bread, another characteristic which is very important, the bread was heated in fire. Of course, if you want to eat bread or the cracker, you know, at some point you've got to put it in the oven. But let's put that picture again, because I want you to see it. Now, if you look well, you can see not only that bread needed to be going to the oven like any other bread, but you will see marks of burnt marks on that bread. There are burnt marks. That is, the body of Jesus was burnt. Wow. The body of Jesus was burnt. Burnt. Where do you see this in the Bible? Well, it was not physical burn. It was spiritual burn. The Bible says the judgment of God fell upon him. And every time God calls for judgment, God calls for fire. Because fire purifies. So the sins of the world was upon him. Your sins, my curses, your curses were laid upon him. And God's fire fell on him and consumed all this so that we be free, so that everything be paid for. But Jesus absorbed all this in his own body. Are you still with me? You know, in the Old Testament, there was the temple, and in that temple, there was in the courtyard where everybody could see, there was an altar called the brazen altar. The brazen altar for the burnt offerings. So when you brought a lamb or a goat or some kind of animal that was required, the priest will first of all, take the blood out, cut the throat of the animal and take the blood. And then when he has taken the blood, he will take the animal, put it on the altar called the burnt altar, and burn that lamb. And the burning of that lamb means all the sin, all my sins were consumed by the fire of God. I think I got a picture of that, of a lamb being burnt. Let's see if we got this. Okay, take your time. That's fine. I got so many things that it can be a little bit. All right. So the thing is, is that that animal was placed on that altar, and after taking the blood, this animal would be burned to a cinder, right? And this is what also happened for the Exodus. If you read the account of the Exodus, when the people went away, leaving Egypt on their Passover, God gave instructions that the lamb that they were going to eat had to be roasted lamb. So it had to be in fire, and no leftovers was to be kept. And if you had leftovers, you had to burn everything to a cinder. So I think we got an issue with our computer here. So let's carry on. So I want to read to you from Isaiah chapter 53, verse 6. The Bible says, "All we like sheep have gone astray and have turned everyone to his own way. The Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." The Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. So the iniquity of us all was laid on Jesus and consumed by the fire of God. Isn't that awesome? So when you look at the matzah bread, when you look at that bread, you realize that there was the body of Jesus, no sin, striped, pierced, burnt, all because of me. Now, I want you to know that this is not just something that you learn. Hey, this is nice. This is nice that it happened like this. I want to let you know that this is actual, and it has the power now to touch and transform and hit your life like never before. It's not just a pie in the sky. It is the real power of God. Amen. And then there is, apart from the bread, there is the wine. There is the wine. Now, the wine is also important because the wine represents the blood shed. Now when you look at the wine or the grape juice, right, because it's red, it reminds you of blood. So this is a good reminder of the blood of Jesus. Now, concerning wine, we all know that, can we bring that picture, if possible, of that burnt offering? Can we bring that? No? All right, that's okay. Okay. Got a little problem with that. So, well, it came and it left. Maybe the animal was not. Yeah, come on. Praise the Lord. I mean, I really wanted to show you this because so that you can get a clear picture of what I'm talking about. So this burnt offering or the brazen altar was in the courtyard of the temple, right? In the yard of the temple. And this is where the priest will first of all cut the jugular throat part of the animal and take the blood out, and then put the animal on the altar and burn it up. And this is what happened to Jesus. He was burned up with the judgment fire of God, or so that we would not be judged. He took our judgment and we go free. That's awesome, guys. Awesome. So let's carry on. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The wine represents the blood. Now, when you think about the wine, you don't have wine by just eating grapes, okay? You have fruit juice. You don't have wine. Wine has to be crushed, right? And I put here, wine has to be treaded upon and completely crushed, then left to ferment in the dark. It has to be treaded upon with feet. You know this, the process. Maybe you've seen that of people stepping over those grapes. It has to be completely crushed and then left in the dark to ferment. And this is exactly what happened to Jesus. He was crushed. His blood came out. And then he was left in the dark for 3 days in the tomb. On the cross, first of all. Left alone in the dark and put in the tomb. So this is what happened to Jesus. Now, all this was for us to be reminded every time we take communion that Jesus went through to save us so that we can never experience the judgment of God. We can never experience the fire of God. We can never experience the justice of God, but we can experience the forgiveness of God, the grace of God, we can experience the deliverance of God, the freedom of God, and life everlasting. Now, looking at this bread and wine and letting our imagination work through that, because God has given us imagination, right? And this is now when you take the bread and you take that cup of wine or grape juice, let your imaginations go there at the cross every time you take it so that you can see it. And when you see it, faith cometh by seeing what you see in the spiritual. Faith will come, right? And then you'll say, God, I claim my blessing. I claim my deliverance. I claim what you have paid for. Hallelujah. And I don't have to pay for it. I don't have to pay for it. If you go to a restaurant and you know, you've ordered something and somebody comes and say, don't worry about it, I'm going to pay for the bill. You won't ask for the bill again because it's been paid for. Come on. It's been paid for. So you don't have to double pay because it's been paid for. You go to that communion and in your imagination, you go to that cross and you say, I'm claiming what Jesus has paid for me. Amen. Woo! Let's carry on, right? Let's carry on. Now, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Yes. Now, looking at this bread and wine, let your imagination work through it. It will make us see the price that has been paid for all of our sins and curses. It will help you to imagine what Jesus did, what he paid for at the cross. Now, for all of our curses, I want to ask this question. What is a curse? What is the curse? So, we could debate on that a long time, but I'm going to give you the short cliff note version of what curse would mean. The curse is simply God's sentence to judge sin. It's God's sentence to judge sin. And sin is nothing else than breaking God's perfect law. When you break law, God's perfect law, you have a sentence. Adam and Eve broke God's law, and the sentence was death. So the sentence that is on humanity is death, because we are all sinful, right? If you go through a traffic light and you don't stop, and you should have stopped, there is a sentence for that. I don't know what it is, according to the cop that is, you know, arresting you. There's a sentence for that. There is a sentence if you steal something. There's a sentence if you kill someone. There is a sentence for every law that you break. But breaking the law of God, there is just one sentence, is death. And with death comes all kinds of curses. Like, death is the mother curse that brings all the little ones behind him, behind it. What are the little ones? Sickness, disease, depression, poverty, hatred, all the kind of junk comes from death. Now, what is death? Now, death, I've said this many times, but just in case to refresh your mind, you know, death is not annihilation. All of us are going to live forever, whether with God or far away from God, but we're going to live forever. So death is not annihilation. Death is separation. The moment that Adam and Eve sinned, their spirit was separated from God's spirit. And all humanity and all creation was separated from the very life of God. And separated from the very life of God brought all kinds of things that death brings, you know? All kinds of things. Pain, sickness, disease, all that kind of thing. Hurt. All that you can think of that is negative came from this. Just like breaking earthly laws, you go to prison, and in prison you are separated. You are separated from your family. You are separated from the free will. You are separated from your friends. You are separated from the things you love. And in prison you can experience all the little things like violence, lack, torment in prison. And so we all, humanity, have sinned and have been separated from the life of God, and we are living in the prison of sin and tormented by the jailer called the devil himself, the Satan himself. But praise God, Jesus came by dying on that cross. Listen, by dying on that cross and paying for our curse, our death, we are now released. We not only go free, but we are now released from that prison. And we are now released from the one who is in charge of that prison, Satan himself. We are released from him. Galatians chapter 3, verse 13. Let's read this, guys. Come on, give me some help this morning. 1, 2, 3. Read. But Christ has what? Rescued us from what? The curse pronounced by the law. When he was hung on the cross, he took upon himself the curse for our wrongdoing. You could say that Christ took the sentence for our wrongdoing. I should have gone to prison. I should have stayed in prison for eternity. But he paid for it. Now I'm out of prison. Not only am I out of prison, but the jailer is under my feet. The jailer has no control over me. If some of you maybe have experienced prison time, you know there is a jailer. But when you're out, he has no jurisdiction over your life. Woo! Yeah, 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 yeah. You're under my feet. All because of what Jesus did for me. Now, I want to let you guys know that this is not just fairy tale. This is not something, oh, I know about this. But are you living it? Because it's real. It's real. Oh, my Goodness gracious, God is so good. So he delivered us. He said he rescued us from the curse. He rescued us from the curse pronounced by the law, by the judge. He rescued us. How? When he was hung on the cross, he took upon himself the curse, the sentence for my wrongdoing, so that I won't have to pay for it anymore. And this is why, as a church, we grow wild in worship. Because everything that we can do is bow and say, God, you are awesome. And we worship you, and we worship you, and we worship you. Amen? So he was hung on that cross. He paid for our guilty sentence. Now, the judgment of God fell upon him and consumed him. And then at the cross, he said it was finished. When all that happened at the cross, there was a thick darkness. The darkness, the Bible says, especially in Matthew, it says the darkness came all over the earth for 3 hours. 3 hours. Because the judgment of God was upon him. What a savior. What a savior. We're about to watch a video. Of course, this is a reenactment of what happened spiritually. It's in CGI, computer animated, you know, pictures. But it speaks a lot about what really happened. So I want you to watch that video. But watch that video letting the Holy Spirit speak to you. Because I think it's powerful. It's really powerful of what Jesus did for us at the cross. All right, guys, we can show it anytime. Thank you, Lord. He absorbed everything on his body. He took our curse. And then he said, it is finished. Because everything was done, everything was paid. What a Savior we have. What a Savior in Jesus we have. Looking at the cross through the lens of the Holy Communion brings healing, brings freedom, bring everything that Jesus purchased for us. Now, when you look, looking is not just looking vaguely or looking, with a distraction. No, looking means gazing, looking intently. John chapter 3, verse 14 and 15, Jesus said this to Nicodemus. And as Moses lifted up the bronze snake on a pole in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, so that everyone who believes in him will have eternal life. So he's referring to a bronze snake that Moses lifted up in the wilderness. Now, what is that bronze snake all about? Now, if you read in the book of Numbers, I think it's chapter 21, when you read this, you realize that during the time of Moses, the children of Israel had become very rebellious towards Moses and towards God. And God allowed fiery snakes to come and bite them. And when they were bitten by those snakes, they died. Like a lot of people died. Fiery snakes will come, just show up and they kill them. So then they turned to the Lord and cried out to God. And this is what happened. Let's look at Numbers 21, verse 7 to 9. Then the people came to Moses and cried out, "We have sinned by speaking against the Lord and against you." And by the way, I just want to say this. This is why it's so dangerous to speak against those in authority in your life. Right? "Pray that the Lord will take away the snakes," they asked. So Moses prayed for the people. Then the Lord told him, "Make a replica of a poisonous snake and attach it to a pole. All who are bitten," like, look at that part, "all who are bitten will live if they simply look at it." If they simply look at that pole, that snake on a pole, that's what happened. They'll be healed. So Moses made a snake out of bronze and attached it to a pole. Then anyone who was bitten by a snake could look at the bronze snake and be healed. Wow. I want to show you a picture of that bronze snake, of the bronze pole, bronze snake on a pole, which was made of bronze. Moses, the Bible says, made it of bronze. Now, bronze is synonymous of judgment, right? In the Bible, when you see bronze, especially in the temple, you know, it speaks about judgment, like the brazen altar, like it was made of bronze. And that's where the animal was judged. So it speaks about judgment. Now, a snake speaks about the curse. We all know how mankind fell because of that stupid snake in the garden, right? A snake. So a snake on a pole means the curse is being judged. Are you with me? The snake on the pole means the curse is being judged on the bronze. That's what it says. And when the people looked at it, they realized that their curses, their sins, was judged on that pole. And because of the judgment was taken on that pole, they could go free and they would be healed. Are you with me? So it was not just looking. It was looking intently. It was looking in faith. And Jesus made this comment to Nicodemus. Let's show that again. John chapter 3 verse 14. If we put this John chapter 3 verse 14 again. And he says, "As Moses lifted up the bronze snake on a pole in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up,
so that everyone who believes in him will have eternal life. So Jesus is comparing himself to that pole, that bronze pole with a snake on it, what happened in the wilderness. So this is synonymous of the cross of Jesus. Now listen to me. This is so important. The cross is the judgment of God on Jesus. Are you with me? That's the bronze pole. But Jesus is the snake on the pole. Can you imagine that? Jesus is the snake on the pole? Yes, because the Bible speaks that he became our curse. Listen. He took our curse, but he became our curse. If you don't believe me, let's look at the same verse that we looked earlier in Galatians chapter 3. But we'll look at this time in Galatians chapter 3 in the NIV version. This is what it says, and I want everybody to read it with me. 1, 2, 3. Read. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by what? By becoming a curse for us, for it is written, curse is anyone who is hung on a pole. He became our curse. When God looked at him on the cross, God saw curse being judged in Jesus's body. Wow. And here's the beauty of that. When the children of Israel will look, just by looking at it and believing in it, they will be healed. How much more the cross of Jesus, if you contemplate it, it will heal you, it will deliver you, it will set you free. How much more the blood of Jesus has the power to cleanse you from everything. If a bronze pole and a bronze snake could do that, then, but the cross of Jesus, praise the Lord, the cross of Jesus has infinite power to redeem every person from every curse and every sin. Somebody shout hallelujah. Now, got so many things to say, but I got to rush here because time is running out. But I'm going to say this also. This is why we take Holy Communion. Because Holy Communion brings us to that place where we can gaze at the cross and be blessed. If you're not taking Holy Communion, you're missing out. If you're going through a sickness, a disease, if you have children that have left home, if you have a problem in your marriage, if you have a problem in your place of work, any need you have, Jesus has paid for it at the cross. My great advice to you is get back to Holy Communion as often as you can, and do it by faith, and look at the cross and be saved and be delivered and be restored. And this is why in this church, God has given me the instructions from the beginning of the year to do Holy Communion every week. So that every week, we together as a congregation by faith, we can look at that pole where Jesus was crucified. Amen. Now, one last thing that I want to talk to you about, that some of you might have an issue with that, is 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 27. So let's read that. Therefore, whoever eats of this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. Now listen, now look at that. Just show you again. Whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner. Everybody say unworthy manner. Will be guilty of the body and blood. Everybody say body and blood. Okay, let's continue. But let a man examine himself, so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks, again, in an unworthy manner, eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning, everybody say discerning, the Lord's body. Okay? Not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason, next one, many are weak and sick among you, and men sleep. So men are dead. Sleep means dead, right? Now, without going too far in a long explanation, let me just say this. When people see the word unworthy manner and examine yourself, immediately many tend to think that he's talking about sin in my life. Well, that's probably part of it, but that's not mainly what he's talking about. I grew up in a church when if you take communion, you had to make sure that you go to the priest and have all your sin purged before you took communion. That's what, at least that's what they say, which I never did, but this is what they said. Right? This was the idea. You got to have all your sins removed. And I know a lot of good Christians that would not take Holy Communion because something weird happened during the week. They've done something that they regret. They've done something really bad. They look at porn. They lost their temper. They did this or they did that. I don't know what. Something happened. And because they feel so ashamed, they won't take Holy Communion. Look at me here. Jesus, are you with me? Jesus took the very thing you are ashamed of. And this is why you should not stay away from it. You should actually go to it and receive his forgiveness, his grace, and his release, and his life, and everything that he has paid for. We are not to stay away from it. If you have messed it up during the week, if you were, you lost your temper while coming to church today, and you say, oh no, I'm not going to do that. I feel so unworthy. I'm telling you, this is the moment to take it, because he gives you forgiveness and for your sins, and he wants to cleanse you of all unrighteousness. Now, what was Paul talking about when he said that people were sick, were weak, and some of them died? What was he talking about? He was talking about not discerning the Lord's body and his blood. Everybody say discerning. Another word would be recognizing. In other words, they would take Holy Communion in an unworthy manner and they would take light of it. They would think light of it. They would not discern what it has the power to do. They would just take it like bread. They would just take it like wine, ordinary wine, ordinary bread. When all that is speaking of, it's speaking about the blood of Jesus. It's speaking about the broken body of Jesus on the cross. And because they don't recognize that, they never get the blessing of the cross. They never get the healing of the cross. They never get the deliverance of the cross. And they go away sick and they die. When God has provided a way for us to be released from that, to be free, to be healed, to be delivered, God has released it to us in Jesus. It's like the paw of the serpent in the desert. Like, just imagine somebody gets bitten by a serpent and he walks away and say, oh, this is a bunch of, fables that I'm not going to listen to. And he walks away. Well, he walks away and he dies. But if he recognizes what God has done, he lives. Are you with me? So let's read a last scripture here, before last scripture. 1 Corinthians 11:20, this in the same passage, this is what Paul is saying, the same passage, right? This is what he says. When you meet together, you are not really interested in the Lord's Supper. You're not really interested. You take it lightly. For some of you hurry to eat your own meal. Go ahead. That is, in other words, they used it as a meal for them, right? Without sharing with others. As a result, some go hungry, while others get drunk. Now listen to me. This is what was happening in the Corinthian church. He was writing to the Corinthians. In the Corinthian church, they came together for the Lord's Supper, and they had other things apart from the bread and the wine, and they would look at it like a buffet, right? And some would come, and if, instead of recognizing the wine as being the blood of Jesus, they would get drunk on the wine. They would take it in an unworthy manner. Are you with me? What? Don't you have your own homes for eating and drinking? Next part. Do we have a next part? No, we don't have. Yeah. So this is what Paul was saying to them. He was saying, don't you eat and drink in your own home. And when you come, don't use those elements that are given on the table so lavishly. Don't use it as a buffet. But recognize the broken body of Jesus and recognize his shed blood. And you will be delivered and you will be healed. Somebody shout amen. Amen. Hallelujah. So guys, I'm done with that Holy Communion teaching today. So what I would say to you as your pastor, do not take that Holy Communion in an unworthy manner. Now, the word Holy Communion is, holy means set apart, right? It's not a diet. It's not a meal that is a common meal. It's set apart. It's God's meal, right? Holy means set apart. So do not take Holy Communion in an unworthy manner. Listen, very important. We're not done here. Please. But take it by faith. In what Jesus has done. Remember and recognize. Everybody shout recognize. Remember. Say remember. Remember and recognize that Jesus paid that price for us. If you are sick, listen. I'm really having a heart-to-heart conversation here with you. Please. If you are sick, if you are weak, if you are fearful, if you have panic attacks, if your children are turning their backs on you, if you're facing a wall in your life, if the devil is oppressing you, if you can't sleep at night, if your finances are drying out, there is hope for you in what Jesus has done. I know taking the bread and the wine looks stupid. It looks weak. But the Bible says God uses the weak things of this world to shame the strong. So will you have that childlike faith and say, I'm going to take that Holy Communion and believe God for a transformation in my life. There is power at the cross for every need through Holy Communion. Let's say that again. There is power at the cross for every need through Holy Communion. The last verse that I have to bring is this. And I want everybody to stand up with me. And as we get ready to take communion, we're going to read this verse together. 1, 2, 3. Let's read. The message of the cross is foolish to those who are headed for destruction. But we who are being saved know it is the what? The very power of God. That bread and that wine that shows what Jesus did at the cross. Man, this is the very power of God. I want the ushers to take the matzo bread, and I think you can be served with a little juice, if you can get the juice. Somebody get me the juice. Can you get me a juicer? Thank you. Oh, all right. Thank you. All right, you can open the cup for the juice and hold your matzah bread in your hand. Hallelujah. And I'm going to say, the devil is going to try to make you believe that you are unworthy. But we are unworthy, but he made us worthy. Amen. All right, let's everybody be served. I just want to say, the devil might want make you to feel unworthy, but you got to talk back and say, I was unworthy, but I was made worthy by the blood of Jesus. Come on. And I'm not approaching on what I did or did not do. I'm approaching the throne of God based on what he did for me. And this is why I'm going to take that blood. I'm going to take that wine, that juice, and that bread. Just to show how much I value what he did for me. So guys, as we take that bread, look at it with the holes in it. That matzah bread, it's unleavened, no sin in the body of Jesus, made of wheat, right? It was beaten repeatedly, right? It was crushed. The matzah bread has holes in it. His body was pierced. His body was striped. And his body knew the firing judgment of God. And it has burnt marks on it. Because Jesus went through all this just for me. Now picture that. And Jesus is saying, and the Father is saying, for I so loved you that I gave you Jesus, that whosoever trusts in me should not perish, but have life everlasting. For I did not come in the world to judge the world, Jesus said, but so that through me, the world might be saved. In the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and said, this is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And then he, at the end of the supper, he took the cup full of wine. He said, this is my blood poured out for you in remission of all your sins. The wine of the new covenant. Do this in remembrance of me. Remember that I went on that cross, on that pole as a snake, and I was judged so that you can be free, so that you can be healed, delivered, and blessed by the Heavenly Father. Let's all eat and drink at the table of the Lord. I'm going to ask the worship team to come and join me. Please stay standing if you can for a few seconds. Just close your eyes. And maybe the Holy Spirit is saying to you, now is the time for you to receive what he died for. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. All right, you may be seated.
beginning, the line drawn in the sand, the end to all my striving. Now I am born again. There Jesus was forsaken, so I will never leave. His grace is my salvation, the gift of God, the work of Calvary. It is done.
Well, I hope everyone very much enjoyed the message today. Thank you so much, Pastor. And this whole series has been very powerful, very meaningful. So I'm going to encourage you Move into your week in remembrance of this message. Remember all of these opportunities for Holy Communion and doing it in a worthy manner. We're looking forward to a new month. February's coming up here. Teresa, you have an announcement? I'm sorry? Yes, abide prayer tonight. Thank you, Teresa. And we've got announcements all over the place next week. We're going to have men's Bible study on Wednesday. Be here next week for service. But you know what? Let me just ask the Lord to bless you today. Father God, thank you so much for what you've done for us. I ask that you bless us, that you keep us. Make your face shine upon us. Be gracious. Lift up your countenance upon us and bring us your peace. Be with us. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so much, everyone.